Brothers and sisters in Christ, may the Lord give you peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. In today's Gospel, the disciples are under lockdown for fear of the Jews. After more than 12 months of pandemic, we know too well also what it means to be locked down for fear not of the Jews, but of the deadly virus. We have to live in a kind of quarantine and to observe all the means of protection. So we lock down. The locked room where the disciples were stands not only for the fear of the disciples to be attacked, it stands for all kinds of blockages caused by fear in the life of human beings. It can be a hardened heart as the result of an injury. And when we are disillusioned and frustrated, we often try to protect ourselves and go into a mode of personal lockdown. We shut the door. Today's gospel story, however, gives us good news. No bar is strong enough to hinder the risen Lord to break through and to surprise the disciples. No lock is so refined that it could keep away the Lord when he wants to enter. No heart is hard enough that the Lord cannot soften it one day. At the difference of Thomas, it may take more than 1 week. Sometimes it takes months, even years. But never forget, not the disciples, not Thomas was really looking for the Lord, whom they believed that he was dead. It was the risen Lord who was looking after the disciples, and he still does it with us. He's looking after you and me. Jesus does not enter empty-handed. He comes with gifts, and with a mandate. The gifts, you heard it, peace be with you. Peace is one of the most important things we need in our hearts, in our families, in our communities, among the nations. Listen to the preaching of Pope Francis, and you have continuously this. Peace. It is not by chance that the first word of the risen Lord to his disciples has become the liturgical greeting the bishop uses at the beginning of the Mass. He imparts the peace of the risen Lord to the church community, sharing of the peace as the gift of the risen Lord. Then receive the Holy Spirit. With him, the love of God is poured out into our hearts, using the words of St. Paul to the Romans. He, the Holy Spirit, is the divine principle of life. And then there is the mandate to forgive sins. It is the gift of the divine mercy. Again, no lock, no bar can keep away the Lord. Give him a chance to let our hearts be changed. Now, when we are celebrating the Holy Eucharist, he wants to enter, and he has the power to do that. Like Thomas, we may be similar to students who are slow on the uptake. Jesus is ready to give extra tuition, confronting us with his wounds like he did with Thomas. Thus, He shows us that the crucified and the risen Lord is the same. It is his manifestation of love. He says, look what you have done to me. Look there, the crucified. I accepted it out of love for you. It is divine mercy in action. He was wounded that we can be healed. The gifts of peace, of the Holy Spirit, of reconciliation and forgiveness are not private spiritual gifts. They imply a mission. Everything stays under the word of Christ, as the Father has sent me, I am sending you. Jesus trusts the disciples, although they made bad figure during his public life and especially during his passion. Nevertheless, he trusts them. And we are not better than the first disciples. Despite our weakness, the Lord does not shrink from trusting us and mandating us. And it will work if we believe like Thomas. And let us courageously call him my Lord and my God. It's a profession of faith. And let us pin our hope on him. Keeping in mind the words we heard from John in his first letter, whoever believes that Jesus is the Christ has been begotten by God. Begotten by God. And whoever loves the Father that begot him loves the child whom he begets. Here, my neighbor, all those who are there. Begotten by God, they are our siblings in the Holy Spirit. Loving God is keeping his commandments. Let us pass the test in the strength of his Holy Spirit, now when we are renewing again our faith and being nourished by the gift of the Holy Eucharist. Amen.